Okay, so the last section is, why is there something rather than nothing? The reason why I brought this up is because this is a main topic usually in atheist and Christian debates. They'll say that, it just doesn't make sense that everything popped into existence from nothing. You need a God to create all this. And I think, actually there's two possible answers. One possible answer, and the problem is that neither one of these possibilities makes sense to us humans. One possible answer is that something always existed. The other possibility is that something came out of nothing. And we do not understand either one of those situations because we don't experience that in our lifetimes. But those seem to be the only two possible answers. And so personally, I think logically the answer is that there's something always existed because I don't believe that something can pop out of nothing.
Exactly.
Now just for some of my fellow atheists, they'll say, well, Lawrence Krauss says something came from nothing, and he doesn't mean nothing in the philosophical sense of absolutely nothing. For example, he'll still say there was fields, for example, and quantum foam and things like that. So he doesn't really mean absolutely nothing. He meant nothing. He means nothing material. There's a material that can pop out of the energy fields, but it's like, where'd the energy fields come from? You still need something. But now the problem is, the Christians will say, well, you need a God. Well, God is still this. Where did God come from? This, you can't escape that. You can't do special pleading and say, well, God just always existed. One of the problems you have with that is that, I mean, if God always existed, he's supposed to also be all-knowing. But imagine this: God can't explain where he came from because he doesn't know. He just happened to find himself always existing, and he just happens to be all-knowing and all-loving and all-powerful. It's like he didn't create himself, so he has no idea how he came to be. I mean, I think that's a funny outcome of it. So, what are your comments on that?
Well, yeah, I mean, you're right about when you say that something can't come from nothing because there's nothing in nothing to create the something, and all somethings come from something. So you're right about that. And otherwise, you get into this infinite past regression, which you just hit that point where you said, well, then where did God come from?
Well, I'll talk about the infinite regression thing because I think there's a different answer to that. But anyway, go on.
So anyway, so therefore, the conclusion is eternally existing something. There's always been something. There had to be. And that's the only logical possibility because the alternative isn't acceptable because you say, then what came before that? I think where the problem comes in is we're being anthropomorphic, which just basically means as humans, we're projecting our reality and our essence onto God, which, I say there's the laws of physics and the laws of spirits. And so God's a spirit, so he doesn't have the same, he's not limited like we are. And, of course, then I prove the Bible, and what he says in the Bible in Isaiah 46:9, he says, I am God, there is no other. I am God, there is none like me. And then in Isaiah 43:10 and 13, he says, before me no God was formed, and after me there shall be none. From eternity I am he. So that's the reality. That's the only logical possible conclusion. And, when you say, well, we can't grasp that, what's basically being said there is we're having a feeling like that doesn't make sense to us. We can't relate to that. But that feeling is coming from a human body and a human mind. So therefore, that feeling is irrelevant to reality.
So what do you think about, I mean, how did God, so you believe God always eternally existed, right?
Right.
So imagine for a second you're God, okay?
Okay.
You've got to be thinking, how did I come to be here, always existing? I mean, how did this happen? He didn't do it himself because he didn't make himself. How did he just always happen to be there?
Well, like I'm saying, where that question is coming from within you is within your bo from your body and your brain, your mind.
Yeah.
See? But that's human. See, so you can't project, I mean, God is much more than human. And then he states right in the Bible what I read, and
Well, I'm just trying to understand it. I mean, there's, I mean, I'm just trying to say, is there a reason to, is this understandable? Are you just trying to say it's not intelligible? It's not understandable? Is that all you're
trying
to say?
Well, yeah, let me give some examples of things that can be real, but that can't be grasped. For instance, can a tree grasp comedy? No, it's just like it just floats in the air around the tree. Can a paramecium grasp romance? No. Can a blind person from birth grasp color? No. Yet comedy, color, and romance do exist on a certain level and in a certain way.
Okay, but wait, yeah, but we do have logic and reason, and we use it a lot in civilization. So trying to apply logic and reason to the situation, I think, are you just saying that we can't apply it?
Well, that is the logic. I just did apply it.
No, you're saying your logic is that we can't understand it, I guess.
Yeah, that we can't grasp it.
Because we're too feeble-minded.
Well, no, it's just like I just gave three examples of realities that exist, even though certain things can't grasp their reality. Well, this is just one of them. As human beings, we can't grasp this reality. Yet it's the only logical possibility.
But I'm saying it's not logical. It's not logical to think that there's something that just found himself to be always existing. You're saying that's logical. How is it logical?
Because it's reality. It's the only possibility. It's the only logical possibility.
That's called begging the question when you say it's reality, because we're trying to figure out if God is reality, and you're saying because it's reality, it's just the way it is.
No, I'm saying it's the only logical possibility that there has to be an eternally existing something, because something doesn't come from nothing.
Okay, so let me back up a little bit and talk about this infinite regression. So what sometimes people say is that, okay, to get to this moment, we had to have a prior moment. And to get to that moment, you had to have a prior moment. And if you can't have an eternal past, because you can never find that prior moment if it keeps on escaping you, basically. So therefore, there had to be a beginning at some point in time. And I think that's okay. But I believe this universe could have came from something else. And let me give an example. For example, if you look at a person's growth from an embryo to being born to be an old person, you can observe a person through their life, and you can say, like, okay, I know this guy when he's 50. I knew this guy when he's 30. I knew this guy when he's 10. I knew this guy when he was born. I knew this guy before he was born with ultrasound. But at some point, you know, you can go back to when the egg and the sperm both joined, okay? That was the first time that DNA came together, two sets of chromosomes. But if you go before that, there is an egg and a sperm. There was not that person. There's something different, but yet there was a history prior to that. In the same way, this universe could have came, you know, there's multiverse theory. There could be some kind of other natural realm out there. Maybe time started at the creation of this universe, maybe not. I don't think scientists are unanimous that time began at the Big Bang. I don't think that's a settled point. But time could have started at the Big Bang, but it could have came from something else, just like an embryo comes from two different things.
I agree.
So
it came from God. It came from a spiritual realm.
Yeah, but see, I think the problem there is you're jumping to magical thinking, where it's like, well, we don't have the answer, so therefore magic is the best answer.
Well, no, I don't. I wouldn't say it that way. I'd say it this way, that you know, physicality, okay, the first law of thermodynamics says that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, and that includes mass. Mm-hmm. So if it can't be created, the tag on that line would be it can't be created by something physical. See, so the conclusion there is that means something non-physical had to create the initial physicality.
But that law is also just for closed systems, and the universe doesn't have to be closed at all. For example, if there's multiverse theory, there's no closed universe.
Well, yeah, the multiverse in this case would be spirit. But the thing
no,
is
no,
that
no, no, no. I'm just saying more natural.
Okay, in a more natural way of looking at it, I would say that it's a closed system in the sense that energy or mass has never been observed to spontaneously combust or to come about new from nothing.
Okay, so we're going to leave it there because we're out of time on this segment.